In this video, I will show you how you can perform a logistic regression using SPSS. This video won't cover all the assumptions that can be found in a separate video. First of all, let's take a look at our data. The data we have here are real data based on the ship Titanic, which sadly sank in around the early 20th century. It sadly hit an iceberg. These are all the passengers who were on board, and we have lots of different pieces of information recorded about them. The outcome of interest, so our dependent variable, is whether or not people survived. So they got a 1 if they survived, and they got a 0 if they sadly died. Other things were also recorded, variables such as the passenger class they were in, what their country of residence was, age, and other variables too. So to perform the logistic regression, and this is a binary logistic regression because our outcome is 1 or 0, we go to Analyze, Regression, Binary Logistic. And then we need to move our outcome variable, which in this case is survived, here into the dependent box. We leave the default as Enter. Covariates are the independent variables that we're interested in. So we want to move passenger class over here, country of residence, age, and we're going to look at gender as well. We need to now tell SPSS which of our categories or which of our variables fall into a categorical variable. So we know that passenger class does. I'm going to change the reference category here to first, but you might find it more useful to change this to last. As we discuss the output, you will see why you might need to come back and change this. So I'm just going to click first, press change, and now you can see it says first in brackets. If you don't do this, it's absolutely fine. It's just the default will be the last category that you have. So for example, if you have a 0 and a 1 for gender, your first category will be whichever one is 0, and your second category will be, or your last category will be the 1. For country of residence, we have a 0, 1, 2. So the first category would be 0, and number 2 would be the last category. For passenger class, if we have first category, that would be a 1 for first class. If we used the last category, that would be a 3 for third class. Age is a continuous variable, so we're not going to put that one in there. Country of residence is categorical, and just to be consistent, I'm going to change this one to first as well. And again, gender, that's also categorical, and once again, I'm going to just change that to first. Continue. So the next one that we might want to click on are options. So under the options, there are a few different things that you might want to click. Here we're just going to click classification plots and the confidence intervals for this, which is actually the odds ratio. Now, sometimes this test is used as a goodness of fit. You may have been told to use this, but recent evidence suggests that this might not actually be the best way to look at the best fit for a logistic regression. It has a few drawbacks. So I'm just going to highlight that it is there, but I'm not going to select it today. And then I'm going to press continue, and I'm just going to press OK. So we have quite a few tables that will appear in our output. So you can see there's a lot here. A few things I want to draw your attention to. The first table just tells you how many samples we have in the analysis. It tells us that we have 263 missing cases. So for example, I know that a lot of these are in the variable age. So if you were to repeat your regression and for some reason you were going to remove the variable age, this could actually have a fairly big impact on the model and maybe the other variables, because suddenly you'll have more passengers included than you had before. So it's worth just bearing in mind how these numbers might change, and it works it out as a percentage as well. It just reminds you what the codes are for these two groups here, and it even works out how many passengers we have in each of our different groups. And it reminds us as well which order they're in. So this would be a 0, a 1, and a 2. So this would be our first category, this would be our last category. And that might be useful to know. One thing I would draw your attention to, so you're going to see two blocks, block 0 and block 1. Block 0 is imagining that you have no independent variables, so this is effectively the baseline of the model. It's probably not going to be that useful to look at the tables that are in here. See, it's just reminding you, variables not in the equation, that it has not included your independent variables. So don't get confused by these tables. Move on to where it says block 1. Now, the model summary, so we can use this rather than using the good fit test that I showed you earlier that might have some limitations. You could use Cox and Snell R squared. You can use this other one here. And this one is probably the best one to use, Nagelkirk R square. This is actually showing us that we have 46% of the variance in the outcome, so whether they survived or died, of that variable can be explained by R predictors. So that's the equivalent of looking at how well R predictors are working with this model. Then we have our classification table, and this tells you how many passengers were correctly assigned to the correct group. So what we have are the observed results, so what we actually saw, what we actually have recorded, and what would be predicted using our model. So what this is saying is that our model correctly predicts that 522 of the people who died did die, but it incorrectly predicts that 97 of the people who actually died should have survived. So this means it's got a percentage of being correct of about 84.3%. Likewise for survived, we actually have survived predicted correctly as 305. So 305 people who survived were also predicted to survive in our model, but our model predicted that actually of the people who survived, 122 should have died. So this shows you what is incorrect in our model, and this is a percentage worked out how many correctly of the survived group, what did this model accurately or correctly predict, and then an overall percentage of what the model has predicted there. So the last table is our variables in the equation table. This is a bit more complicated and it involves explaining odds ratios. You might want to look at the know-how tutorial to look at odds ratios further, and also the handbook, but I will briefly explain. The first thing you might want to look at is the sig column. This contains our p-values, and this can show you which of our variables are having a significant effect on the model and which ones aren't. So here it doesn't label them very well. It's not very easy to see what groups we have. First thing we should note that when we have a category variable which has more than two groups, you will have an empty cell or two under the B and the SE. See these two for class and for country of residence. So this overall p-value has to be significant for this whole variable to be significantly affecting the model. And as you can see for country of residence, if we move along here, this p-value is not significant. So therefore, we have to say that country of residence isn't really having a significant effect on our model. We have age, which is a continuous variable, and then we have gender. Before I move on, I want to show you a table that's been slightly rearranged. So it's based on this information, but I'm hoping it will make things clearer. Before we do that, we need to just scroll down a bit further and we need to just double check something. So here it says the predicted probability is of membership for survived. So this will help us actually interpret our whole table. So I'm just going to open this table. So all that's happened here is I've removed the variable which was not significant, so that was country of residence. I've pulled out some of the important bits of information, and you saw earlier that we had a blank line had a blank few bits of information. So this is what you have to imagine, that whichever one you choose as your reference category, in this case we chose the first one, which in this case means first class here, and for gender actually means males. So if we had chosen the last category as our reference category, then this third would move up here and female would swap places with male. So whichever is your reference category is effectively given an odds ratio of 1. If you have an odds ratio of 1, this means that there is no difference. If you have an odds ratio less than 1, this means that it has sort of fewer odds. Whereas if you have an odds ratio that's greater, so let's look at gender as an example. Here, because this is 12, this is effectively saying that females were 12 times, had 12 times the odds of survival than a male did on board the Titanic. You'll notice here where we have country of residence that because they cross 1, 1 is effectively our null hypothesis. So that means that if there's a possibility that our null hypothesis could be true, you're probably not going to see a significant difference. So if they cross 1, then you're probably not going to see a significant difference. Whereas all the others, you can see they're either less than 1 as they are here, or they're a lot greater than 1. So hopefully this starts to explain our results. Age is continuous, so this is a bit different. This is effectively saying that this is the odds ratio for every year. So it might not look that different from 1, but it is significant. And what you can do is you can actually do calculations that will allow you to work out the difference of a 20-year-old compared to a 1-year-old. So I do have that calculation down here. So what we would do is we would take our odds ratio and we would basically take it to the power of the difference. So the difference between a 20-year-old and a 1-year-old is 19, and this would give us an odds ratio of 0.5, which actually would suggest about a 50% chance, an odds ratio of 50-50 for a 20-year-old in terms of their survival. So as I say, odds ratios are quite complicated. You might find it more useful to read through the tutorials and also the handbooks, but hopefully that gives you a brief introduction to how to perform a logistic regression using SPSS.